we worship the God who was. We worship the God who is. We worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors. He parted the raging sea. My God, he holds the victory. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. We sing to the God who heals. We sing to the God who saves. We sing to the God who always makes a way. 'Cause he hung up on that cross and he rose up from that grave. My God's still rolling stones away. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. Shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. We were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. 'Cause we were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house There's joy in the house of the Lord today, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today, and we won't be quiet. Shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise.
Stand in front of us and sing and shout out the praise of your God. We welcome you this morning. Rejoicing, but either way, he never grows weak. Amen.
He is the defender. So when we feel weak, when we're in a room and everyone is rejoicing and our heart is breaking, He is still our God. He is still your God.
Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. With all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. I will serve the Lord with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, with all my strength. I will serve the Lord with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, with all my strength, with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, with all my strength. I will serve the Lord with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, with all my
Well, good morning. You guys can take a seat. Thanks for being here this morning. It is July 2nd today. It's July 4th weekend, a holiday weekend, and I missed it on the blue, red, and white, but my son didn't, and he's got the red, blue, and white shirt on. So if you're in that holiday spirit, thanks for being here. If you're not in that spirit, thanks for being here as well. But the worship team is right and is true this morning and helping us to lead in that we can love the Lord your God of all your soul and all your mind. I'll get to you in just a second. But before we move further, we have to acknowledge that some of our teens, where's Lucas at? He's over there. Don't go down, Lucas. Stay up here. Kerrigan, come on up. Stephen, come on up. Is Grayson here today? Somewhere? Grayson, come on down, man. Come on. Let's see how quickly you can get down here. We have a group of students, and then we have two chaperones that are going, and they're leaving on Tuesday night, and these are just half of our students coming, and they leave on Tuesday night to go to Tampa Bay, Florida, so they'll be roughing it for about a week. But they're going to Tampa Bay, Florida for something called NYC, and it happens in our Church of the Nazarene normally every 4 years, but because of the pandemic, it's been 6 years. But it's called NYC for Nazarene Youth Conference. It's an opportunity. It's about a week-long opportunity for students from all over the world, from Nazarene churches, to get together, to worship, to serve, and to go to the beach. And so it's an awesome time, and it is a busy time. I've taken a look at the schedule, and they are busy from their departure on Tuesday to when they come back next Monday night or Tuesday morning. It's kind of complicated because of the flight schedule, but here it is. Here's what I'm asking from you. I'm asking from you to pray for our students and also to double pray for our chaperones, okay? It is going to be an amazing time of worship. They're going to have opportunities to serve their Tampa Bay community. They're going to have opportunities, sure, to have fun, free time, game time, that kind of thing. But it's a week designed where they can encounter God. And they can make maybe life-changing decisions or choices and maybe hear God's call on their life. And so we are excited for them, but we want to send them out with a prayer. So three specific things that I'd like you to be praying for, not just these four, but our whole group this week. Number one, for peaceful travels. Traveling is not easy for everybody, and then flying is not easy for anyone. It's just difficult for some, just keep the travel aspect in mind. Secondly, that they get the rest that they need to make it through the week and that they can sustain the energy, right? You're going to need that. No, Kerrigan's good. She's got that. And third, that they would be open to God's call on their life. And so we're excited for them. So if you'd pray for them this week, would you just show hands? Will you do that for me, for them? Cool. Thank you. So the church believes in you, and I won't make you stay up here very much longer, but I do want you to stay up here during prayer. Karen, it's good to see you. It's good to see you this morning. Will you keep the Edgerton family in your prayers as well? Dana's mom passed away just actually a couple hours ago this morning, so earlier this morning. So just keep them in your prayers as they kind of navigate that transition. And the ushers are going to come forward in just a minute, but I'm going to pray for these NYC students specifically, and then we'll have worship and giving. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for giving us this holiday weekend to maybe grill out or watch fireworks or take maybe some time off from work. But most of all, and most importantly, thank you for giving us this time in this place to worship you. Lord, as we move into Monday, and as we move into Tuesday, we are sending some of our kids, some of our teens, some of our students, and some of our adults to a faraway place, Florida. And so we ask a couple things of you, Lord, that you grant them some peace, some calm as they travel, as they fly, maybe for the very first time or first few times. We ask that you just calm them and still them as they travel. Secondly, Lord, we ask that you move in their lives. And not that you can't move in their lives here in Flint or in Michigan, but we ask that you move in their lives at NYC in a special way. That they realize and recognize your call on their life. Lord, we are so blessed and so grateful to have these teens as part of our West Flint family. And we know that you have good things, not just in store for the whole group at NYC, but for each and every one of them that are here today. In your name we pray. Amen. Thanks, Grayson. Thanks for coming down. Appreciate it. We'll be thinking about you guys. It's going to be an exciting time. And parents, we have a NYC meeting after church. Bonnie, you got a praise?
I'm 80 years old.
It's good. Good. We'll do. A lot of needs in our church family. A lot of praises, too, not just needs. And so keep on praying. Caleb, you ready? Come on up. Invite the ushers at this time to come forward and give us the opportunity to give this morning. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for reminders of your moves, your good things in the body here. We thank you for praises like we just heard with Bonnie and praises maybe that we don't hear, maybe times that we need to be reminded of good things going on. And so, Lord, we give all glory and praise to you. Lord, take our gifts this morning or whenever we give, our tithes and our offerings, to continue to do the goodwill that you have planned for us. In your name we pray. Amen. How many of you have ever been to a museum before? Art museum? Okay. I have a picture that you may have passed as you entered the sanctuary. I don't know if you saw it or not. I don't mean to scare anybody, but I'm not gonna pull anybody on stage with me. I'm actually gonna walk back there and grab that if you don't mind, okay? And pull it up here and have you take a look at it. It's an abstract piece of art, and I'm not an artist. I'm not a drawer or a painter or an illustrator, but I want you to take a look at this painting. This is a painting, if you didn't know. Stephen, can you see it okay? Anybody know the name of this painting? Anybody know what it is? This is a painting called Number 6. It was painted in 1951 by a Latvian-American painter named Mark Rothko. This painting in 2014 went for $140 million. Why? I will sell it to you for 100. But what is this? It's nothing. Okay? Let me read you the description off Wikipedia. Lucas, do you mind sliding that over there for me? Out of the way? And guard that. Somebody's going to take it. Here's the description of this painting. Number 6 consists of large expanses of color delineated by uneven, hazy shades. The subtitle of this painting is Violet, Green, and Red. You understand why? Because there's violet, green, and red. Now, I've got a couple questions for this artist. I don't know if he's still alive, probably not, if it was painted in 1951, although he was probably four when he painted it. It doesn't seem like much. I mean, what is this painting? As you can tell, I don't appreciate abstract art. I like fine art, like art that's actually like real and you can tell what it is and that kind of thing. This doesn't look like art, but it's abstract art. And some people have an appreciation for abstract art, but art is all in the eye of the beholder, especially abstract art. And abstract art, or the meaning of abstract art, is normally discovered kind of communally, like through the audience. So one person looks at this artwork, if you want to call artwork at the very beginning, says, wow, that's amazing, you know, what is it? Second person looks at it, third person looks at it, fourth person looks at it, and then 70 years later, it's sold for $140 million. And so I want the kids back there drawing on sheets of paper to save your artwork. Because you never know what's going to come out of those tables back there. But art is interesting, but artwork like this, abstract art, is difficult and challenging and maybe even impossible looking at that picture to decipher and discover the meaning. Like, what exactly is that? I mean, what is going on here? What did the artist mean? What did this painter mean? What's going on? So you can't tell the original meaning or purpose or idea of this painting by just looking at it, by just observing it. You just can't do it. Some paintings, some drawings, some illustrations, you can. But abstract art like this, you can't. We're going to be talking, beginning today, in the next couple weeks, July and August, we're going to be talking about what is God's best for us, for you, in different areas of your life. Things like work or labor, things like rest, things like technology, things like relationship, things like money. What is God's best for you? And those things are much easier to discover than the meaning behind this. We could ask the artist, we could ask the painter what the meaning behind this is, because there's kind of a phrase, mother knows best. Mother knows best means that the one who birthed you, the one who formed you, the one who nursed you, the one who fed you, the one who changed you, maybe the one who disciplined you, that person knows best because they have a part, a huge part, in the creative or creation process. Here, with artwork, we would say the creator knows best. In an abstract piece of art like this, only the creator, only the artist, only the painter, only the illustrator would know the meaning or the intention or the purpose of their piece of art. And we could argue with that artist, okay, surely you didn't have that like huge, deep, like intention with three colors, right? I mean, and the artist would explain to you what he was going through, what he was going through, what she was going through at that time. This is why I painted this. This is why this was this color. That's why I transitioned it this way. But we discover through Scripture that Creator knows best, or our Creator knows best. And so the intention and the meaning and the reason behind certain things that we go through in life, we're going to discover through Scripture and the revelation of Jesus, we're going to discover what God's best is for our life. In Psalm 103:14, the psalmist writes this about God in the creative creation process. The psalmist writes these words, "He knows how we are formed." If we want to discover, if we want to know why we are here, how to plan, or why we're formed, or discover what's best, the deepest things of life, we need to go to the one who formed us. We need to go to our creator. And so what is best when it comes to the deepest things of life? In the New Testament, we're going to go through a couple different phrases. There's a phrase that Jesus says, you may have heard it said, but I say. You have heard, but I tell you. And so this is Jesus' kind of clue or hint to us that we've been trained to hear, or we've been trained, or we've been taught or instructed, this is the way, this is what's best for us, but my way, Jesus says, is going to be radically different. It's going to be a huge contrast. In fact, sometimes it's going to feel like the complete opposite. And so Jesus kind of gives us a clue here in the New Testament. What's best for you is not what you've heard, what you've been taught, what you've been instructed, but it's what I tell you. It's what I say. And then he has multiple things that he tells us. And so that's what we're going to be talking about today and the next couple weeks. There are note cards in the maybe chair back in front of you. If you want to take notes, there's not any space really in the bulletin, but it says God's best. And so that's what we're talking about this summer. What is God's best in certain type of issues, in certain type of themes? So we're going to go way, way back to help us determine what God's best is. We're going to go way, way back to the book of Exodus, to the story of Exodus, where we discover God's people. God's people are crying out, they're enslaved, they're trapped, they're snared, and they want a way out. But even when they couldn't see it, Even when God's people couldn't understand it, God had their best in mind. We talked a little bit about this last week, but and you probably have forgotten, but the message was actually on memory and not forgetting. But the message last week touched a little bit about this, where God's people are kind of in transition, kind of in the middle between where they're going, where God has kind of directed them, or where God is guiding them, in between there and then where they've came from, where they've departed. And so they've left slavery, and they're on their way to freedom. And on their way to freedom, there's a couple times where they kind of pause, and they kind of remember back, or they think they remember how good things were when they left, but it actually wasn't true. And so they thought they knew what was best. They thought that going back to where they came from was best or better than where God was guiding them. And yet through this transition, this process, God knows best. And so God's best for the people of God is freedom. These people are physically enslaved. They may have been in chains. They were in bondage. And here they think, well, it couldn't have been that bad. And God's saying it really was that bad. And so God's best for his people is freedom. Then we fast forward a couple books in Scripture to 1 Samuel, and this is chapter 8. And this is one of my favorite stories in Scripture, where God's people are crying out. They're looking at other groups, they're looking at other nations, and they're noticing something about these other nations. They're noticing that these other nations are led differently. They have a different type of ruling system. They have a different type of government than God's people have currently. God's people, they are relying on God as their leader, as their king, but they're noticing these other communities, the other groups of people have a human king, and they begin complaining, they begin moaning, they begin grumbling. Hey, we want a king like these other groups. And so they go to Samuel. They complain to Samuel, and they say in 1 Samuel chapter 8, verse 6, give us a king to lead us. And so Samuel goes to God and he says, here's what your people are saying. Here's what they're saying to me. And so the Lord tells Samuel something. And Samuel goes back to God's people. And we can find what Samuel says to God's people in 1 Samuel chapter 8, verse 11. Here's what's going to happen to God's people if they end up getting a king like they want, which is not God's intention for them. Here's what Samuel says in 1 Samuel chapter 8, verse 11. Samuel said, "This is what the king who will reign over you will claim, as his rights. He will take your sons and make them serve with his chariots and horses, and they will run in front of his chariots." So the king won't sacrifice himself. He's not going to be doing anything extra or anything sacrificial. It's going to be their sons that will have to sacrifice. The king will assign to be commanders of thousands and commanders of fifties, and others to plow his ground and reap his harvest, and still others to make weapons of war and equipment for his chariots. This king that God's people are demanding will take your daughters to be perfumers and cooks and bakers. They're going to work for him. Not for their own gain or for their own future, but for the king's gain and king's future. He will take the best of your fields and vineyards and olive groves and give them to his attendants. So this king that God's people want, the king that they think will be better than their current setup, is not only going to send their sons in front of his chariot, sacrifice their sons first. He's not only going to take their daughters and employ them in his service for his benefit, but he's also going to take the best of their fields, vineyards, and olive groves and then give them away to his buddies or cronies. Verse 15, he will take a tenth of your grain and of your vintage and give it to his officials and attendants. Your male and female servants and the best of your cattle and donkeys he will take for his own use. The best of the livestock. He will take a tenth of your flocks, and you yourselves will become his slaves. And you know what the people said? Okay, never mind. That sounds terrible. That sounds brutal. We're not going to do that. We're going to go back to God's plan. We're going to do what God's best is for us. No, that's actually not what they said. Here's what the people really said. Keep in mind, these are people that just heard their sons will be sacrificed first. These are people that just heard their daughters are going to be employed as cooks and bakers and perfumers. These are people that just heard they're going to lose right off the top the best fields and vineyards and olive groves. These are people that just heard they're going to lose one-tenth of their cattle, the way they make a living. These are people that just heard that they themselves will be this king's slave. And here's how they respond. We want a king over us. Then we will be like all other nations, with a king to lead us and to go out before us and fight our battles. They had no interest in living God's best. See, God's best was him as their leader, as their king. And the people said, "No, it doesn't matter the possibilities or what's going to happen. If we go to a human king, we still want a human king." These are people that God literally formed, physically created them, formed them, knit them in their mother's wombs, but also formed them as a people. The people of God would not have been a people without their God. And so God says, "I am your God, and you will be my people." He literally forms them. Creator knows best. And here they think, they know that what would be best for them is a human king, not God as their king. And things do not turn out well for them. Turns out pretty poorly for them. So we fast forward to Jeremiah 29:11. This is a pretty popular, kind of a well-known passage, one that you read when you're debating whether to buy a new car or not. You're like, should I get a new car? Well, God did say his plans, you know, are to prosper us. And so, but here's what the verse means. The verse means when the people of God are facing exile, which is a pretty not great time, like not the best time. They're facing a very rough time, challenging time, time that is going to encourage them, that this time that they're in is going to encourage them to kind of honestly lose faith in God's plan for them, God's promises for them and to them. And so God speaks through Jeremiah in this time of uncertainty, doubt, fear, difficulty, whatever. And here's what the Lord says, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you, even though it doesn't feel like you're being prosperous. Plans not to harm you, even though it seems like you might be harmed. Plans to give you hope when it doesn't seem like there's a lot of hope, not even like a sliver or a glimmer. And plans to give you a future." And this is a time when the people felt there was no future, that all was lost and all was crumbling. And yet, when we find ourselves in this type of situation, and we hear these words, that God has a plan for us, plans to prosper us, when it doesn't seem like we're being very prosperous, even though we're working very diligently and very hard, plans not to harm you, plans to give you a hope when it seems honestly hopeless, when plans to give you a future when it doesn't seem like you have much of a future, and yet here is the Lord entering into this kind of dark space in our lives and hearts and minds and saying, I have a plan for you. Plan to give you a hope. Plan to give you prosperity. Plan to give you a future. And plans not to harm you. And this requires trust. And so God's best for us, God's best for me or you as an individual requires trust. And this is a very, very difficult thing to do, to trust in the Lord with all your heart. We're cruising through some of the most famous verses in the Bible this morning, but we're going to go to Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6. My NIV version says this, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways submit to him and he will make your paths straight." Question for you this morning, how much do you trust God? How much do you trust God? Proverbs 3 here says to trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do you do that? That's challenging. That's difficult. It's kind of easy to do when things are going pretty well. But challenging when things aren't going so well or when things seem dark and heavy. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways submit to him and he will make your paths straight. Trusting God means to look to his guidance in what we face. And kind of the issues, the things that we struggle with, the situations of life, trusting in God is measured on when or how frequently or how much we place our trust in the Lord. The writer here says, all your ways. He's saying all the things, all the issues, all the decisions that we face. See, on our own, we can come up with a lot of ideas, a lot of concepts, a lot of choices on what to do when it comes to the big things, the important things of life, right? And when it comes to work, when it comes to relationships, when it comes to money, when it comes to technology, when it comes to other things, we can come up with all these sorts of ideas, but if we don't trust the Lord enough to let him speak into our lives and our minds and our hearts on those issues, we're not really trusting the Lord with all of our heart like the writer here calls us to do. And so God's best, when we're looking at God or looking to God for what's best in our life, we're looking to Him for what's best for all areas of our life, all of our heart, the scripture goes. And to lean not in our own understanding. Our understanding is limited. It's finite. It's human. And so we need to discover a way to get wisdom, to get discernment. And so we're going to fast forward again to the New Testament. This is Philippians chapter 1, verses 9 through 10. And the Apostle Paul is writing the Philippian church as they kind of discern what is God's best, what is God's will for us in this place, in this time. A church much like ours, facing issues, facing situations. Here's what the Apostle Paul writes. And this is my prayer, that your love may abound more and more in knowledge and depth of insight, so that you may be able to discern what is best and may be pure and blameless for the day of Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ to the glory and praise of God. But I want to hone in a phrase here. The Apostle Paul says, it's highlighted in yellow, so that you may be able to discern what is best. How do we discover? How do we learn? How do we discern what God has in mind for us when it comes to things like work and relationships and technology and money and other things? How do we discern that? So I want to share with you three words there. All start with C, so it makes it a little bit easier for you. The first is this: discernment is Christ-centered. In the next few weeks, we're going to be emphasizing what Jesus says about how to live our life. And so when it comes to the major issues, the main issues, we're going to look to Jesus first. And so this means that we'll live differently than the world. When we look to Jesus to discern what is best, we know that He says different things than the world. So when it comes to work, the world is going to say, work this way, work this long, work for these reasons. And Jesus has some different things to say about work. When it comes to relationships, the world says, here's how you need to relate to one another. Here's how you need to connect with one another. Then we look to the words of Jesus, and it's quite different than what the world says. When it comes to technology, the world says this: here's how you need to embrace it, here's how you need to connect with it. Now, Jesus doesn't mention Facebook or Twitter, but there's some principles that Jesus shares when it talks about relating to the world that we can relate to technology. And so when we talk about what is best, what's the best path forward, what's the best option, what's the best choice for us moving forward when it requires discernment, we're going to look at what is best through the lens of Christ. And so discernment is, first of all, it's Christ-centered. And so whenever there's a coin flip or a toss-up between what Jesus says and what the world says, in this series, in this church, we're going to lean towards what Jesus says. And so discernment is Christ-centered. The second is discernment is contextual. There's absolute truth. Sin is sin at all times, in all places, in all moments. But there are some things that are contextual. Let's take technology, for example. Ancient parents didn't have to worry about their teens tiki-taking or tick-tocking or whatever. Okay, just didn't have to worry about that. They didn't have to worry about their teens on phones while they were riding the donkey. You know, like technology, like, they didn't have to worry about that. But they did have to worry about different contextual issues. Like their kids doing this, or their teens doing that, or adults doing this, and adults doing that. Different contextual issues. And so discernment is also contextual. Things like technology, especially when we get to that week, that you're going to see that's really contextual. There's some things in Scripture that talks about this time that we're in. in the issues that we face at this time, but they don't directly address the issues that we face. And so discernment is also not just Christ-centered, but it's also contextual. The third thing discernment is communal. God's best for us is to live in a community of believers. Many times throughout the New Testament, the New Testament writers talk about this community of faith as a body, like a fleshly human body with many, many members. So the metaphor, the illustration is human body with many members. And the point that they're driving at is not only are we better and stronger together, but it's that it's God's design from very creation of the church that we are not isolated, that we don't do faith alone, that we don't follow God alone, that we're not in a relationship with Jesus by ourselves. And so Satan can use separation and isolation to his greatest advantage. But when we're in a body of Christ, when we're in a church, when in a group of believers, it's God's best for us. And so discernment sometimes takes a communal effort. Here's an example. Combined with online watchers this morning and you physically, there might be a couple hundred people represented in this service, participating in this service. And I don't know what your deepest thoughts are, your darkest thoughts are, your addictions, or what you're facing at this moment. But I would imagine some of you facing that type of an issue would say, you know what? There's no one here that gets me. There's no one here that gets my struggle, what I'm going through. Now, that might be true if you're going through faith alone, but that's certainly not true in a body this size or in the body of Christ. And what I've learned in my few years being with you is that whatever you are going through, somebody has already went through. And so somebody can help you. They can partner with you. They can walk alongside of you. And so discernment, living a life that's Christ-centered, is best done in a group, in a community. And if that would be you this morning, you say, there's no one that gets what I'm going through. I know that there's other things that I can share with other people, but no one gets this. That's not true. And I would encourage you to reach out to me or somebody working at the Connection Center, and we will hook you up with somebody in this body that has already walked through this issue that you're facing. But discernment done is Christ-centered, or best done is Christ-centered. It's also contextual, and it's also communion. God's best is ideally worked out in a body. People that are focused on living and giving and grieving like God. And so the world says, here's what's best. Here's how you need to live. Here's what you need to do. And in this series, we're going to really take a look, a deep dive on what is God's best revealed through Scripture, and also revealed through the life and the acts of Christ. God has a best for your life. God has a plan, a wonderful, amazing plan for your life. And so this week, in the next couple weeks, we're going to explore that plan, what it means to live God's best in different areas of our lives as we center on Christ. Let's pray. Father, we praise you and we thank you, first of all, for who you are and what you've done. Lord, no matter where we're at in life, no matter what we're doing, no matter what we've done, you've invited us into an encounter to follow you, maybe for the very first time this morning, or to continue following your call. Lord, we love you, we praise you, and we worship you. In your name we pray. Amen.
stand with us. We're going to sing the first song that we did this morning, House of the Lord. We're going to sing a little shorter version of it, but if you would. House of the Lord, there's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet, we shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord, our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet, we shout out your praise. We were the beggars, now we're we were the prisoners, now we're running free. We were forgiven, accepted, redeemed by His grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. We were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven. House of the Lord, there's joy in the house of the Lord today, and we won't be quiet, we shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord, our God is surely in this place, and we won't be quiet, we shout out.
The amazing truth about that song is, yes, God is in this place, but it's not the only place that He's going to be this week or this weekend. He's going to be in the places that you go and the places that you will be, and so you can be the love and the mercy and peace of Jesus Christ to every place that you go this week. Have a blessed week. Thanks for being here this morning. We'll see you soon.